So let's examine demographic characteristics and processes. So how do we organize and characterize our society? So we're going to take a look at some of the easy ones that are pretty straightforward. So age is an easy one where we say, oh, I'm organizing or I'm going to categorize the population based on age. So it's a common characteristic that we use. Now, an age cohort is a group of subjects who have shared a particular event together during a particular time period. So you see this categorization or this binning of the population based on that time period. So an example is the baby boomer. I'm sure you've heard of that before. This is a group of individuals that were born post-World War II. And there was a whole bunch of, you know, I guess everybody, the war was over and everybody's back home and happy and a lot of baby times, a lot of babies being made. And so there was this nice influx. So those individuals right now would be roughly 52 to 70 years old. And this group was associated with privilege. They grew up with quite a bit of stuff. Life was starting to get good. So they grew up in a time of widespread government subsidies and post-war housing, education, increasing affluent areas in the country. So it was a pretty good time in our civilization, at least in that in certain countries, North America. And so that group of baby boomers now is getting a little bit older. But again, we've categorized based on that event of being sort of in this time frame and that age. Now, consider the elderly, those over the age of 65, as they typically retire and not contributing to the workforce. Now, that's a moving target because we understand nowadays people are living longer, people have the need and want to work longer. So they don't necessarily retire at 65, but we still would classify them as elderly if they're over the age of 65. So we know that as you get to that point in your life, there seems to be a shift in quality of life because now their body, like everything, like a machine, starts to fall apart. And so now they have the reliance on the healthcare system and they need social support. They can no longer maybe drive, they can no longer bathe or dress themselves. And so now they need to get help. They might need a drive and use other, you know, transportation services. They need to go to the hospital and see doctors more often. In the U.S., 10% of those considered elderly actually live below the poverty line. And a lot of this is because they're no longer working, and so they're getting a pension if they have one. And so that typically isn't the same as their normal pay that they were used to getting. And now they're having to get more social services, or the need for social services for healthcare, medications, and these might not all be covered. And so they're kind of spending more. Making less, spending more makes it very easy to very quickly be below the poverty line. Now, we also have the silent generation, or what we call the GI generation. These are individuals that were born during the Great Depression and during World War II. And so they're much more elderly than those that are the baby boomers. And these individuals are the ones that are, you know, older and in the point where they're really unable to provide for themselves and are more at risk for being in this sort of poor poverty line, below poverty line group. By the year of 2025, is estimated that over 25% of individuals in our country in North America will be over the age of 65. So we're getting older, which simply means this is going to be more and more of a prominent issue. And we're going to have to sort of plan for that. So the dependency ratio examines the proportion of elderly versus non-elderly and therefore the need of social support. So as I said, as we're getting older, we're going to figure out, well, how much support are we going to actually need? And so to calculate this dependency ratio, you look at the number of individuals who are under 14 years old, those that are over 65, and you add those together and you divide that by the number that individuals that are 15 to 64. So what we've done is we've taken the really, really young who need help, they need our help, and those that are over 65 that increasingly need our help, and versus those that we considered contributing adults. And that ratio will allow us to understand how much social support is actually going to be needed in terms of a dependency ratio. And it also allows you to compare over time. It allows you to compare over certain, you know, cities, countries, provinces, and say, well, the dependency ratio here is this much because there's a lot more elderly people, or versus this country where there's less. So we know that as you're getting older, you start to have a decline in your physical health, and that can change and impact a lot of different things. Obviously, one would be productivity. If, you know, you have arthritis or if you have low back pain, you're unable to really do the things you used to do, especially if you were a trades, if you were using your hands, cooking, basic personal hygiene, these things become increasingly difficult. So you see a decrease in productivity. You also see an increase in reliance of other people and of the healthcare system and utilization of the healthcare system. You may have been in your 40s, 50s, rarely going to the doctor other than your annual checkup, and now you're there every other week for different things like, you know, this new rash or this new pain, starting to get some memory loss, hearing issues. All of a sudden, you're really tapping into the healthcare system. And also that loss of autonomy. You no longer can just get up and go and do things. You might not have your license anymore. You might need help, assistance getting in and out of a car, getting dressed, getting bathed, feeding yourself. These are really difficult things to give up. Right, so imagine yourself young and able-bodied, the time you go and slip and break your leg, and all of a sudden, you really can't do much for yourself. You have crutches, you can crutch along, but you need help getting ready, you need help cooking and cleaning. It's kind of annoying, and actually can have a huge impact on your actual mood and your behavior and your personality because of that loss of autonomy. Now, socially speaking, there's also some impact. As we get older, it's easy to say that we're going to need more individuals that are trained, that are professionals and specializing in agents in this age bracket. So we know for a fact that treatment strategies and medications and biochemical procedures are different in the elderly subpopulation. If you look at the product monograph of any medication, so grab, you know, even Tylenol or another perhaps a prescription medication you take, and read the little folded brochure that comes inside. That's called a product monograph, and it'll explain safety, adverse events, how to take this medication. If you read it and you look at the area that says dosage, a lot of times it'll have its own bullet for those that are over the age of 65. That's because we understand that physiologically speaking, your body changes and you're no longer able to metabolize and interact with medications in the same way as if you were, like, say, 55. So now, that also means you need those who are well-versed in that. So training pharmacists, training doctors, those who normally understand how much you should write a prescription for antidepressant, now you have to change that because you're prescribing it to the elderly. So there's actually a small subspecialty of those who focus on the elderly subpopulation in terms of treatment. Age-friendly services, even realignment of social values. Now, if you're going to need help or if you're going to have to go get your license done or forms filled out, you're going to need a really large font, perhaps, or you're going to need somebody to assist you in filling because of the cognitive decline, because your eyes don't work as well. There's a lot of issues, a lot of things that you need to put in place to be able to service and help the elderly function. In terms of society, both culturally, socially, and economically, we need to adjust what we know and think are reality and actuality and what we perceive to be the cultural, societal, and economic roles of our elderly counterparts. So just because they're old doesn't mean they're dead, right? You hear that all the time. So just because they're old doesn't mean they can't work or they can't contribute. They're actually very, very, a very, very useful part of our society, and they actually bring experience. They're able to contribute. You know, they're our grandpas and grandmas, right? Really, really important. Life course theory of aging is a process mediated by three important factors, and it's not a surprise that we're seeing these same three components because they basically comprise and make up the BPS model, basically the model of this course, which is biological, psychological, and social factors. So there's been a shift in age-related expectations with increased life expectancy, and that the life course theory has slightly changed and has been influenced by some of these factors. So say, for example, you know, if you have somebody who's getting older on an age, are they forced to retire at 65 or can they keep working? If they have no physical issues and cognitively they're still there, they're good at what they do, why should they have to stop? So as we have gotten to live longer on this planet and our average life expectancy in most countries is still increasing, it's changed fairly dramatically over the last 20 years, it's only going to increase. I know in North America, it used to be a huge deal when you would hit the age of 100. And now, I don't want to say it's common, but it's much more common to hear that somebody's turning 104 or, you know, is really it's getting late into the 90s, seems to be much more common. But as that happens, as we have this increased life expectancy, you're going to have to see also a consequential shift in age-related expectations. If we all, most of us were living to 60s, 70s, then yeah, I can see how, you know, okay, you're getting old, you should retire at 65. But now if we're living to 90, 100, well, maybe, you know, there's things that we used to not be able to do at 70 that we can easily do at 70 because we know we still have quite a bit of time left, you hope. So other theories of aging include age stratification. And this is when we use age as a means to regulate appropriate behavior. So in the image we have here, you know, there's certain things that you don't think old people should do. You know, are you going to see an old guy shirtless at the beach surfing? Or do you expect to see them, you know, sitting in a walker or sitting with other elderly people playing bingo? Who's to say they can't do either or both, right? So we've stratified and we've set up these norms for what we think is appropriate behavior for the elderly. There's activity theory, where certain activities and jobs are lost with old age and social interactions must be there to replace them. So if you're forced to retire or you can actually no longer, you know, be a construction worker digging ditches, or a tradesman because it's just difficult to see and you have really bad arthritis, that's understandable. So you can no longer do those activities or jobs. But what has been stated is that you need to then replace that with other jobs and roles. Have that social interaction. It needs to be replaced. So, you know, you might not be really aware of it, but just going to work every day and engaging with that interaction with others is extremely important. If all of a sudden you retire and all you're going to do is just get up and sit and watch TV all day long, you really have lost a huge portion of your life. And we need to appreciate that. That needs to be replaced with things like, you know, hanging out with other elders or family members or other friends and do other things. Take up other hobbies, be involved, use your mind. There's also another phenomenon called the disengagement theory. And this is where we realize there's a greater divide between both individual and society as you get older. And so we have the idea that as you get older, sometimes you withdraw and you say, well, I'm older now, so maybe I'm going to, you know, not hang out with the rest of the group. And vice versa, as a younger individual, you kind of say, well, we're going to go out and play, or I'm going to go for a walk. I'm not going to bother grandpa because he's old and he's just sitting there. You know, we don't have the same discussions because now they're no longer in the workforce or they're no longer engaging, perhaps, in the day-to-day life that you are. So you start to see this divide. And so, again, consciously, you need to make some awareness of, well, no, we shouldn't be doing that segregation and we shouldn't be excluding based solely on age.